I mentioned last time that Plato is writing the stuff that you've just read just after a great cataclysm in Athenian society, around 400 BC or later. Later, most likely, because Socrates is killed in 399. But it's after that time. It's after the great days of Athenian glory have passed. Athens is the first great democracy that we know about, anyway. And yet it flourished. It was at its peak in about 450, 50 years prior to the death of Socrates. And Plato's birth was right around the time of the beginning of what's called the Peloponnesian Wars, the wars between Athens and Sparta. Those wars lasted for about 27 years, and Athens lost. Athens not only lost the war, but the democracy was overthrown for at least a year, was restored, and never again did Athens reach the height that it had achieved 50 years before. Now, we're going to perhaps get back to this. I'm not sure how the conversation will go. But this is kind of like the collapse of the Soviet Union, if you think about it that way. And some of the stuff that's going on in the Soviet Union, people sort of agonizing over lost former glory, some of that same stuff was going on in Athens. And Plato actually represents one of those people who thought, well, see what happens when you have a democratic government? You know, we've lost our former glory, and the only way to restore that is to get the right people into control of the government. Before getting to Plato, let me just give you some stuff that's going on at the same time. This isn't philosophy so much, but I think it just seems like it might be sort of useful to sort of see where this all fits in the rest of the world. Now, civilization has been around for a long time. We talk about Plato and Aristotle as the fathers of Western philosophy, and if you know that pre-Socratic philosophers mostly just left a fragment here and a fragment there, and that all we've got from them is just sort of hints about what they thought, and the first people that we really have complete books by are Plato and Aristotle in the Western world, that might lead you to suspect that, well, you know, sort of civilization is new at this time, but it's not. I mean, the first urban civilization, the first city-based civilization, goes all the way back to about 3,500 in what's now Iraq. It's quite a bit, you know, that's 3,000 plus years before Athens. But Europe was not so well developed. About the time that Iraq's civilization was beginning in Europe, just to give you an idea, back 3,500 BC or so, people were just beginning to form defended villages. They were just coming together 3,000 years before Plato to form what we would think of as towns. So that there weren't cities there. They were just beginning to defend themselves. In Plato's time, here's some notes that I've taken. In East Asia, China was in the middle of a period of warring states, warlords who were battling with one another. It was not by any means a united empire at that particular moment. Chinese civilization had been growing and flourishing in one form or another for 1,000 years already, so it was quite old. Sometimes Socrates, who is the voice that you hear or you read in the Republic, even though Socrates, of course, did not write that, Plato wrote that. Socrates is sometimes compared to people like Buddha and Confucius, and so it's interesting to note that in China, Confucius lived prior to Socrates, prior to Plato, therefore, from about 551 to 479. And in India, Buddha, now there's some controversy about when he lived, but the Indians say that he lived from about 563 to 483, which puts him well before Socrates and Plato. But the Japanese estimate, I mean, they have a different estimate of when Buddha lived. They think he lived between 448 and 368. I'm not sure whether that controversy has been resolved, but if the Japanese estimates were right, that would make Buddha pretty much an exact contemporary of Plato's. So that would be interesting, because Plato, as I say, was actually 427 to 347, but it sounds like Buddha just lived longer. Now, maybe not, about the same. In Africa, in North Africa, Carthage dominated the Western Mediterranean. So we're talking about a period in which there is trade on the seas, and the Greek city-states along the coasts of Greece are very much involved in that trade. Carthage, by the way, is is where Tunisia is today. And in farther into Africa, there was a culture called the Nok culture in northern Nigeria, so that there were cities and some acquaintance between what was going on in Africa and what was going on in the Mediterranean region. In America, the temple building cultures in Mexico and Peru, the earlier ones, were flourishing. And in North America, there were some burial mound cultures who've left remains that we can still find in the eastern woods here in North America. So that's what was happening kind of around the world, and it's at this moment that what we call Western culture more or less began to get established in Athens. Now, I got a question for you, and that's this. What did you find? What's going on in the Republic? What did you see there? Yeah?
They seem to like talk about like as if they're making laws or something, but they're like arguing what's right or wrong, or is right what pertains to the stronger, like who rules.
Is right what pertains to the stronger? What specifically are they asking about when that issue comes up?
Like asking if, like, if a ruler makes a law, I mean, is it for his own interest or for the?
That's exactly right. But I want a word. I'm looking for a single word. Anybody? What are they talking about?
Justice.
They're asking about justice, and you're right that as we enter this excerpt, that's taken from the larger book, I think the first person on the scene is Thrasymachus, who's his estimate of what justice is. Now, there have been a couple of other people in the real dialogue from which this is taken. There have been a couple of other suggestions, but Thrasymachus really is the most interesting suggestion among the ones that Plato rejects. And Thrasymachus makes it with some degree of hostility. And his suggestion, once again, is what? Thrasymachus says justice is what?
Whatever the stronger party says is right.
Whatever is it, the way he put it, that's exactly right, but let me just be accurate. It's whatever is in the interest of the stronger party, of the stronger. Now, what does that remind you of anything? Now, this is a view that certainly has not lost popularity. If anything, it may be more popular now than then, but it's a view about justice, that if you want to know what justice is whatever's in the interest of the strongest party within society.
Darwinism, somewhat?
I wouldn't have said Darwinism, but I guess there's a similarity. You're right, to the idea that the survival goes to the fittest. But something, I'm thinking about something, a doctrine involving justice and right and wrong and morality in general. Yeah.
Machiavellian
is it? That's Machiavellian. I don't think that word applies. Here's why. I think Machiavelli is someone who wouldn't have taken much of a stance on questions about which things are right and which things are wrong. I mean, that just wasn't his project in writing the things that he wrote. He was writing advice to princes about, you know, how they should proceed if they wanted to preserve their power. And questions of right or wrong, he put to the side. But here's a doctrine of right and wrong. It says, those things are right that are in the interests of the strongest party. Now, I don't think it's often put like this, but there's at least a couple of different doctrines that I think are familiar to you about right and about justice that this reflects.
Even in democracy, because it's majority rules.
That's absolutely right. I mean, democracy would be one kind of example, and we're going to get to that in a second. But what I'm thinking about is the doctrine that might makes right. I mean, it almost just parrots the idea that strength is what determines what's right. Now, there's another way of looking at this, because and you might not have thought about it in the same light, but this is just a, this is a very, this reflects a very standard attitude about the origins of justice. You want to know what really is just, what really is right, and what's wrong? Some people will tell you to this very day, maybe, I'd certainly say many people, I don't know about most, but some people will tell you to this very day, there is no objective answer to which things are right and which things are wrong. It varies from culture to culture and from place to place. And it varies as a function of what? I mean, it's got to be a familiar doctrine. It's a doctrine I'm going to call ethical relativism, okay? The suggestion that there is no objective right or wrong, that standards of right and wrong are created within societies, they differ within society. And so what is it that, that determines? I mean, just think this thing through. Think through the logic of this position. What is it on that view that would determine which things would be deemed right and which things would be deemed wrong within a society?
People.
Pardon?
The people.
Well, whoever is able to manipulate the propaganda machinery, if you like.
What's moral?
Pardon?
Whatever's moral.
Not according to this view. This view is trying to define moral.
Right.
It's trying to define the morality. And this view, ethical relativism, suggests that there's no objective answer to the question, what's right and what's wrong. It really is just a function of what people believe. And it's not necessarily the majority, it's not necessarily the majority's opinion on this matter that will dominate a society and that will establish the laws and the rules in that society. Although in a democratic society, that's perhaps the way it will go. I mean, where the majority does have power, then it's the majority who gets its way and whose standards of right and wrong will be dominant. But where a minority, on the other hand, has got the real power, that's where, I mean, it's the minority then that will legislate. We're not necessarily talking only about written down laws, but we're talking about the standards of right and wrong. How do they arise? So what Thrasymachus represents, perhaps, is the doctrine that says that might makes right. He says justice is whatever's in the interest of the strongest, that is, whoever has the most power. And he himself says, well, if you have a democracy, then of course, who is it that has the most power? It's the majority. So there, it's the majority's interest that sets the standards of justice. And I've tried to suggest to you that doctrine is you know, if you think of it not so much as sort of saying, campaigning for the king or something like that. It's sort of like it seems like it's a hard-nosed realism. I mean, a lot of people would think of it that way. There's no such thing as justice. Plato, you're on the wrong, or Socrates, you're on the wrong track. You're looking for something that doesn't exist. All there are people's interests, and whoever has the most power in society, they're going to be able to inflict their view about what's right and what's wrong on everybody else. That's what we'll have to put up with. So that's what Thrasymachus represents. It's a very intriguing and a very widely held, even to this day, view about the origins and source of justice. And it's one with which Plato disagrees. Yeah?
Well, it's kind of true, like with the political lobbyists of today. The rich companies are coming in and having a great effect on the politics.
So you think it's kind of true, because as you point out, that whoever does wield the propaganda power, whoever can buy the advertising, whoever can buy the television time, and a lot of people would say now, or whoever can buy the votes or whatever that difference that means, they do get their way. But that, I think, goes without saying. They get their way. Does that make it just? Where the relativists part company with non-relativists, where I think Thrasymachus parts company with Plato, is not so much in saying, I think you have to agree, well, whoever has power has power. Whoever has power gets to legislate the rules. But does that make them right? Does that make them just? The relativist is likely to say, or the Thrasymachean relativist, the one that's like Thrasymachus, will say, and there's lots of different breeds of relativists out there, they'll say, that's all there is to it. That's all there is to the question of justice and right and wrong. There's nothing more to it. The rest is vapor. I mean, it's, you know, all there really is people making rules. And Plato disagrees. He thinks there's something to justice beyond just this mechanism wherein people make rules. But you see the difference. It's one thing to agree that that powerful interests do manipulate the standards and do succeed at this. It's another thing to say that what they manage to establish then are new principles of justice. I mean, some would say, no, they manage to make injustice the rule rather than justice. And that's an argument that has gone on. This is one of these philosophical arguments that's gone on to this day. You know, like what the standards of right and wrong are, how one can find a basis for them. There are relativists out there. Maybe they outnumber the non-relativists. Maybe most of you are relativists. I'm not one. I'm on Plato's side. Now, this partially explains. I mean, were you able to uncover Plato's attitude toward democracy? He's hostile to it. How come?
Free reign of individual interest.
Loudly?
It's a free reign of individual interest.
Because it's a free reign of individual interests.
Everyone's pursuing their own interests. It's not really for the good of the society. But
yeah, he's certainly, that's a symptom of its wrongheadedness. But what's wrong with that?
It's bad for the whole society.
Pardon?
It's bad for the whole society.
It's bad for the whole society. Could just barely hear. My hearing is going. I'm also trying to get you to speak up so that others can hear you as well. That's right. It's bad for the whole society. But so what? What if it's good for the? I mean, it's good for the individual. I mean, you know, each individual seeks out that individual's interests, and maybe you know the whole society isn't as cohesive or something like that. What's wrong with this?
I think you were saying that there are some people that are better suited for making decisions. Like one thing you spoke of, which I didn't really either understand or agree with, was how children could be of either gold or silver or bronze. I mean, I understand the analogy, but how would one come to uncover whether a child was of gold or
that he's now? Do you remember that part in there when he talks about this as a myth? And we're going to, it's a noble lie. I don't know if he uses the word lie or not, or whether the translator uses the word lie or not, but this is famous as one of the noble lies that Plato says that we should tell to the guardians, the auxiliaries, all these people who we are raising to rule the country, but we should tell it to all the people as well. We should get the people to believe that there is something as a part of each person that determines whether they're to be in this class, or in that class, or in the other class of society. It's largely hereditary, this something, the gold or the bronze. It's largely hereditary, but you know, every now and then, Plato acknowledges, you'll find among the artisans class, and we're jumping ahead of ourselves a little bit because we've got this division of classes that we haven't discussed yet. But every now and then you'll find somebody in the non-ruling class who really ought to be taken out of that class and educated as a ruler. We're jumping ahead of ourselves, and I think we should probably move back. I'll do one further leap. To get to the bottom line on this justice question, because the justice issue isn't the one that I want to focus our attention on. It's really this organization of the ideal state. But Plato disagrees with Thrasymachus. Thrasymachus says that justice is in the interest of the stronger. Plato thinks first, no, and he puts these words into Socrates' mouth. He says, no, there is something that's justice. And then his final conclusion, just to cut to the chase, is that justice is basically doing your job doing the thing that you're best suited to do in the world and not sticking your nose into other people's business. Doing the thing that it's yours to do, the thing that you excel at, that you're good at. And unfortunately, that's not sort of individually choosable. There are things that you're objectively good to do, good at, and those are the things that you should be doing. And he divides them into three categories, which again, they correspond to the three classes within society, but we'll get back to that later. What next? Democracy for Plato, you've got to understand, is actually the rule of the poor, the rule of the people, and among whatever citizens you've got. It's not going to be the rule of the noblest, it's not going to be the rule of the wisest, it's going to be the rule of the rabble, more or less. And Plato understands democracy, if not on a literal majority rule basis, he imagines that in a democracy, there's not going to be anything like a Bill of Rights, like we've got. There's not going to be anything that constrains democracy. Whatever the majority wants, the majority gets. And so that's part of what, I mean, the majority decides that, it's a good idea to execute the tallest, the people over 6 feet tall, or to seize all the wealth and redistribute it among themselves. This is something that, for example, Plato actually anticipates, that in democracy, the poor will simply seize all the wealth of the wealthy, and they'll redistribute it among themselves, because that's what's in their interest. That's what they want to do, and they'll then be in power. And that would be bad. Bad for the wealthy, but bad for society in general, I should point out. So when he talks about democracy, and when he's hostile to democracy, he's not envisioning any kind of society that has a Bill of Rights or other checks and balances against the powers of the majority. He is imagining that you're just going to have majority, the whim, whoever can convince the majority of anything will wind up being able to lead them in any direction that he or she wants. And a major problem with democracy for Plato and for Aristotle is that it would lead almost immediately to tyranny, because you get somebody who's really good at persuading people, some used car salesman or some used chariot salesman, I guess, or actor. Something like that. We just persuade people of that they ought to follow this leader, and then the leader will be able to lead them whichever way he or she wants. And that'll be the end of the democracy, and then you have tyranny. So a real serious problem with democracy is that it's short-lived and leads to the worst kind of society almost immediately, in Plato's view. But it's this whole consideration of what's just and what's unjust that really gives Plato the excuse he needs to start talking about the ideal state. Because really what he pretends he's doing, he pretends, this is the beginning of the book, and at the end of this long, long book that he wrote called The Republic, at the beginning and the end, he talks a lot about justice. And then in the middle, he spends almost all of his time talking about how the state should be constructed, how the state should be designed, how it should be run, and the excuse for going from the consideration of justice part to the business about the state is that, well, if he's going to try and find out what perfect justice is, he really was looking for what justice is. He disagrees with Thrasymachus, but he's not really sure what answer to give to the question, what's justice? Well, in order to find out what's just, let's consider the perfect state, because surely it'll be just. So he figures, now we're going to draw, this much bigger project, we're going to figure out what the perfect state would be like, and that will give us some way to figure out what justice is. And then that's about all we hear about justice for book after book after book. Now, how would you begin that? I mean, how would you talk about, if you were trying to figure out what the perfect state, what the perfect society would be like? Consider that for a second. How How could you figure that out? I mean, what beginning steps could you take to figure that out?
Well, the first thing you need is people would have to be perfect. And otherwise, I don't think you could have a perfect state.
Okay.
People that exist.
But there might be a sort of a symbiotic relationship there. In other words, you couldn't have perfect people unless you had a perfect society in which for that in which they grow up or are raised. For the sake of the discussion, let's just start with perfect people. What were you going to say?
Well, I was going to say, unless a society is constantly improving itself, I don't think it is perfect.
You think there's no end to this?
Well, there's no point to life if it's perfect.
Well, we're talking about life now. I mean, think about the state is, there's a couple of ways of thinking about the state, and you get both of these ways hinted at in Plato. And we'll get to a little bit more of this later, next week, when we talk about Aristotle. But you can think about the state and about society as accomplishing some goal or end. And that way it's like a tool or a machine. You want it to do something. And so what you think society's point is might help you figure out what the ideal society would be like. It would be one that fulfilled its goal in the ideal way. That's what we're later going to call the instrumental view of the state. The state is an instrument that's supposed to fulfill certain functions. But there's other ways of looking at it. And in particular, in particular, the state is supposed to fulfill particular functions in the lives of individual people. It does us good. It does good things for us. That's why we want to have it. And it can certainly get out of hand. Almost everyone would agree. But unless you're an anarchist, you'd be inclined to say, still, there is a proper function for the state. And if we can, you know, as long as we adequately control it, it's a good thing to have. Or maybe you might say it's a necessary evil. It's something we have to have in order to accomplish certain human ends, individual human ends, things that we want, that we wouldn't be able to get without the state. But there's another way of thinking about this, and that's the thinking about the state. And there's going to be a strong sense in which it seems that this is what Plato finally discusses anyway in his lengthy discussion of the ideal state. The state is sort of an end in itself. That what we are means to that end. And by the way, I theorize that each of us is torn between these two kinds of conceptions of the state. On the one hand, I think most of us would be inclined to say, especially here in the United States in the late 20th century, we'd be inclined to say that we're instrumentalist about the state. The state has got a function, and it can either perform that function well or badly or not at all, but it's there to serve a certain purpose, and the purpose has to do with human well-being. Most of us would say we're instrumentalists. But on the other hand, there's this other view, which I would call the organic view of the state, for want of a better term, which seems to suggest that the state is kind of like even an organism, if you like, in which we play some sort of role, but that the health and the sustenance of that organism is more important than any of us as individuals. Now, when I say that I think that we're all torn to some extent between these two views, it's a rare person who doesn't sometimes feel bad if they think that they're not making any kind of a contribution. They're not doing anything productive. That bad feeling, I think, comes out of this idea that what each of us ought to be doing is we ought to be making the point of our life, even, sometimes might seem to us, when we're thinking about things in this way, the point of our life might be that we're supposed to be making a contribution to some larger whole. Maybe not the whole state, maybe not the whole society, but some grouping within society, that we aren't so important as individuals, I think we sometimes, all of us feel, as individualists as we might get on other occasions, we're not really as important as these other larger things to which we make contributions. Even a family, okay, is enough. Between the individualistic reading of our lives and our role in society, which I think often goes hand in hand with this instrumental view of the state, and this other less individualistic view of us and our roles in society, which goes along with the organic view. You see both of those in Plato, and again, these are things that we'll see, you know, going people arguing back and forth about throughout the history of ideas. Plato, though, begins his discussion of the ideal state by speculating what things, what you know, on what looks for all the world like the origins of the state. He's trying to figure out, well, why do states arise? Why do states arise? And he pulls a trick, which later on we'll come back and revisit in more detail as something like social contract theory. He sort of tries to imagine a kind of a quasi-history in which he sort of thinks of people as having existed without a state, but then they come together in at least loose groups. What's the point? Do you remember this? There's a very key element in talking about the beginnings of states, cities, societies even. There's an important principle that leads people to form social groups. What, if you don't remember it from Plato, why do you think they do? It's not. It may be so obvious as to be, you might think it's not worth mentioning, but why do people come together in, if not states, into social groupings? You know, imagine this as some sort of a historical thesis. Not why do we get together down at the Ritz-Keller. That's not what I'm asking. I'm asking why would people form social groupings in early on in the history of the species or our early ancestors? I can't imagine, by the way, that this is something that's happened. I mean, some of this must go on even before we became identifiably human. But yeah,
protection
may be one. I think that's an important. Possibly protection from, what are you thinking of?
Well, early on it would be from like large predators or anything else, but the benefits that you get from coming as a group allows you to survive more.
Well, how? That's the key.
Right.
Defense was one possibility.
Yeah.
Okay,
I was gonna say, just ability to pool different resources,
it's
skills.
The division of labor that Plato hits on, and that's what I wanna call your attention to. I mean, he seems to think that the division of labor, the idea that some people are good at some things and other people are good at others, that's the reason why people come into social groups. Or if they don't really ever come in, it may be that we've always been that way as a species. Nonetheless, that's the feature of social groupings that makes them valuable to people, is the fact that I don't have to now do all the things that are necessary for my survival. I can specialize in the one that I do best and most efficiently, and you can specialize in the one that you do best and you do most efficiently, and then we share, barter, or whatever it is we do. It's this division of labor that in Plato leads to loose social groupings. Yeah?
I guess you could easily argue with that that's an effect rather than a cause of people coming together. Like, maybe there's some other reason, and so when you don't have to fend for yourself all the time, now you have time to specialize.
Well, this is actually a more evolutionary and Darwinian kind of idea, is that, you know, who knows why people got together? Maybe they just happened to be hanging around, you know, they just happened to be in that proximity. Maybe there was no motive at all, but they found out that being in close proximity allowed this to happen, and so stayed there. Or that those groups that did it this way, this is why I'm saying this is sort of evolutionary, it might seem that those groups that actually, those people that allied themselves with others in this way, using the division of labor, were more likely to survive to the point where they had kids and were able to raise their kids, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So that's maybe why someone might offer an argument like that. And I think that's probably more like, if there's any truth to this at all, as being part of the key to understanding the advantage of social groups, that's probably a truer story than one that imagines that people are sort of wandering around all by themselves saying, geez, this is a bummer. We should get together. I could read books and you could do all the work. No. Some people's ideas of the division of labor. But in any case, Plato's argument is that that's what brings people into social groups. That doesn't form a state yet. Now, interestingly, now we've got, you know, now, and he starts cataloging, you know, these sandal makers and hunters and all the different kinds of people that might be useful to basically primitive sorts of social groups. And there's a lot of different people with a lot of different specialties. You might almost think that there's, you know, just dozens and dozens and dozens and dozens of different categories of persons. But Plato's going to forget all that diversity in a second, or he's not going to focus attention on that anymore. He's going to wind up just sort of ignoring that for the whole rest of the story, because this is only pre-social. So we've got all these different people with all their different specialties, but we don't have a state yet. In particular, he doesn't imagine that we have much of a need for defense. That's not what he emphasizes. When does the need for defense against people, anyway, other people, when does that arise? When does the need, and here's the way I'm going to put this now, when does the need for something that's identifiably a government, the need for rulers and the need for military, when does that arise for Plato? You remember? There's a key change. As long as people are living kind of rudimentary lives, it's just sort of, you know, little village peasant kinds of lives. And as long as their needs, you know, we're talking about Greece, you know, Athens, it's a relatively benign climate. So there's a needs for some clothing and needs for some food, but it's a lot of stuff that's just easy to obtain, fish from the sea. It's not a harsh life in most climes in the city-states, in the areas around there. So life is pretty easy. It's when people start wanting luxuries that they need to expand. And then as communities, Plato seems to imagine that adjacent communities could get along just fine and in peace with one another, as long as there weren't any desires for luxuries. But once there are the desires for luxuries, then those groupings, those loose social groupings, are going to start banging up against one another. Maybe internal dissension and internal dissatisfaction of some people in society, maybe envy. Some people getting lots more than other people would make, you know, the people that didn't have so much envious. People, and then our village, our town, as we have to support more and more artisans. There's got to be, now we're going to have CD makers and all kinds of things, and automobile manufacturers, and there's going to be all kinds of luxuries now, things that we don't absolutely need. All this stuff is going to require more and more people to do the work, therefore more and more support in all the stuff like clothing and shoes. We're going to have to expand, and that's going to mean we're going to have an army that will support our expansion, and also now that we have luxuries and we have things that are valuable, we're going to have people who can defend what we have produced against the depredations of others, people who don't have them, whether that's inside our society or whether that's outside. I'm not sure that Plato makes that clear. The main idea, though, is that we're going to start needing something like a military, police force, whatever, but a military, and then we're going to have needs to organize all this stuff, and we're going to need rulers. Now, I have said this in a way that might mislead you. Plato doesn't seem to disapprove of this quest for luxuries. Socrates, his character, does. This may be one of the places where Plato, the author, is trying to distinguish between his character and remind us of some of the historical things that were known about Socrates, distinguish between Socrates and himself. He's not often very careful about that, but he seems to imply that Socrates kind of is nostalgic for these allegedly earlier times when perhaps people didn't care about luxuries. Plato himself moves right past this discussion of this supposedly pure, pristine, primitive society, and then spends all the rest of his time talking about, remember, the ideal state, and it has in it, in a fundamental way, auxiliaries and guardians. Okay? So the ideal state is one, presumably, that is going to provide luxuries. Now, Aristotle will say that what the state is for is not merely for the preservation of life, but for the for the promotion of the good life. And by the good life, it's pretty clear that what Aristotle means is the arts, philosophy, literature, things like that. And those things would be impossible without a state. I think that maybe is the sort of thing that, in part, that Plato has in mind, too. Not just, you know, goods and services. That's not all he means by luxury. It's the good life. All the trappings of the good life. Those would be impossible just based on this kind of division of labor, barter economy that's okay for the primitive, at the primitive level. If we want anything more than that, the good life, luxuries, then we're going to have something different. Before leaping into a more detailed discussion of the argument that Plato offers, I want to touch on two things, the things that can't have escaped your attention, or at least one that can't have escaped your attention, and then another one that may have, I don't know. But the first one is this. This is plainly an idealistic philosophy, even though Plato hopes that the ideal will have practical applications. Nonetheless, he makes it very, very clear. He's trying to figure out what the ideal state would be like. The ideal state, not, you know, a fully practical state. He's obviously doing utopian political philosophy. He's trying to figure out what's the ideal. Now, what I want to do to start out with is, because I anticipate that many of you might be a bit impatient about that. That, you know, you might think, what's the point of doing something that is admittedly, at the very beginning, utopian? And since I suspect some of you may have thought that, wondered that, let me ask you that question. What's the point of doing utopian or idealistic political philosophy? Oh, good. I thought you were going to say none. Yeah.
You got to work towards something, and even though you might not achieve it, you know, you got to kind of set your goals and have something to go for, or else you just kind of flounder and all that stuff that doesn't work.
That's exactly right, and I think that that's maybe a it's a question that arises in philosophy in general, regardless of which kind of philosophy it is, regardless of what kind of philosophical question you're raising. And I think the answer is the same in all cases, and that's that, you know, we do care about practice, we do care about trying to get things right and improving stuff, like we in our own society care about improving the political situation. But efforts to improve a situation, practical efforts to improve a situation, always presume some background set of values, like what's better and what's worse. There's a background ideal behind every effort to improve things. Even if it's not acknowledged, there's always, in every practical effort, there's got to be some direction you're trying to go in. Again, some ideal you're trying to approximate. I mean, even if you are prepared to say, I know we can never reach the ideal. Nonetheless, all efforts to improve, whether it's efforts to improve yourself or efforts to improve society or efforts to improve some particular project that you're working on in one of your fields, requires some notion of what would be better. And that's what all discussion of ideals does, whether in political thought or elsewhere. It's a discussion about directions. It expresses sometimes presuppositions. It may express presuppositions about how things would be better, how things could be made better, what things should be like. Sometimes those presuppositions are defended. I mean, sometimes it's not just presuppositions. Reasons can be given about why we should prefer this over that. But that's what we're doing here, and that's Plato's objective. To do utopian thinking in political thought is to establish a litmus against which to compare real societies. Once we figure out what would be ideal, we can figure out how close or how far our own society is to that ideal, and we can also figure out maybe what steps could be taken to get us closer to it. Yes, sir. Okay?
It's up there.
Cool. All right, so that's one thing. I mean, that's why there's some reason to do utopian political philosophy. Now, the other thing is that Plato begins this, we've already mentioned this in passing, he begins with a discussion of the origins of community. And then that builds into a discussion of the origins of the state. And he sort of asks us to imagine a kind of a history in which people weren't yet organized into communities and they came together. For what reason? For what reason, according to Plato, is it that people come together and form communities? It's the advantages of the division of labor, he says. He says it's because of the division of labor, it's the advantages of the division of labor, that people need to come together into communities. Because it's very, very difficult. It's much harder to be self-sufficient in all the things that you would need to do to survive. It's better if people cooperate, pool their resources, or trade the things that they've done, the products of their labors, to trade these things, and it's much easier for people to get along. That's why people form communities. Incidentally, it might be suggested that no, people form communities because they like to. I mean, they gather together because they like other people. They don't like being lonely. Well, you can almost give a quasi-evolutionary argument that sort of puts the ball back into Plato's court. You might ask, well, why is it that the human species is so social? Why is it that people have evolved in such a way that they like the company of others, that they like to live in communities to some, not everybody does, but to some extent or another? Well, it might be argued, it's because people who had a natural inclination to live in communities flourish better than people who are loners. And we go back to why do they flourish better? Well, it's because it's very difficult to do all the things that you would need to do to survive all by yourself. You're more likely to be successful in surviving to the age where you have children and bring them up successfully, which is what evolution is basically all about. It's much more likely that people would be able to do that if they were living in communities. And so those people who, as a matter of fact, liked living in communities have flourished historically, at least in the early years when survival was difficult. They flourished more than people who didn't. So that's why people generally now like to live in communities. So in a way, it can all be, you know, whether you buy this or not, it can all be fed back into the argument that the reason, and it doesn't have to be historical either. That's another thing I want to get to in a second after I deal with your comment, but just a second. It doesn't have to be historical either. What we're really trying to examine is what's the point or what's the value of community in human affairs. Yeah.
So are you just saying that the people that live alone can't have children, so they can't?
Well, that's the extreme. That's the extreme. But maybe families. I mean, you could go beyond that. Obviously, people who live really alone or anything like people, you know, even ancestors of ours, anything in the mammalian line from which we've come. If they really lived all by themselves, well, yes, it would be difficult to have children. Now, that's becoming increasingly less difficult as technology marches on. Cloning looks like it's going to be possible if you had the right equipment. Maybe you know, 100 years, go to the pharmacy and buy a little cloning kit. I don't know. And then people can live. What a world. Anyway, then people could live literally by themselves. But plainly, that wasn't an option earlier on. No, I want to say something. It's not just the biological fact that you can't have children at all if you live all by yourself. It's that even families who try to do all of the things, like a single family that tried to do all of the things that it needed to do in order to provide for the family, at least in some environments that are not, you know, some environments are more benign than others, but at least in some environments, they wouldn't succeed as well as people who pooled the resources in larger groups, in community groups, in groups that had, and this is where Plato is really specifically talking about the division of labor, where someone is growing the food, someone's doing the hunting, someone's making the pots, someone's making the clothing, someone's, and you know, there can be fuzziness around this. People can do more than one thing, But where there's division of labor like that, where there are specialists like that, that are based more or less on people's capacities and to some extent on their inclinations, what they like to do, to the extent that you get a division of labor of that kind, according to Plato, you get a community that's more likely to flourish. Now, here's the point I said we'd come back to. You may say to yourself, and I think you'd be right to say this, I don't know whether that's how communities got started. I don't know if there was a time when people or people-like beings lived all by themselves, and then some of them got together and pooled their resources, and then that group flourished. I don't know whether that's really right. Yeah?
Could you compare that to native tribes?
Well, native tribes are already communities for sure, right?
Right, but a lot of them function without the outside modern world, and
sure,
you can, you know, evaluate what's happened there.
But they'll have their specialists, they'll have their hunters, and they'll have their basket weavers, and they'll have their...
It sort of backs them up.
Right. I thought that you were providing a counterexample, perhaps. All right. Yeah, I think that he would point to situations like that. But in a way, if you really imagine this as a history, you got to kind of imagine a time before which people hadn't come together, and then they came together, and then they flourished, whereas they didn't flourish so much before. I mean, that's kind of, I mean, it may be. Maybe that doesn't cross your mind at all, but if he's telling something that's supposed to be taken as a history now, he's saying the reason people come together into communities is because of the advantages of the division of labor. If you took it that way, it might seem like, all right, then he's saying there was a time when people they weren't together, and then they came together because maybe they said, yo, we'd be better off if we divided our labor. And the other guy said, hey, that's a good idea. And then they came together. That's not, I think, necessary. Maybe he means to say this. Maybe he's serious about this history. But that's not necessary for this kind of analysis to be valuable. In a way, it's a thought experiment. Think of it as a thought experiment. He's saying, imagine what it would be like if people didn't come together in communities. And think about, you know, what life would be like. And if you do that, the point of this thought experiment, even if it never ever happened, now I imagine, for example, that there may be some sort of moderate division of labor even in pre-human primates, for all I know. They certainly do have groupings larger than families. They certainly do have other animals, other mammals that are not even in the primate line have groups that are larger than families. And sometimes, even in very, very primitive organisms, there's divisions of labor that are hardwired, like consider bees. Consider, you know, all kinds of other creatures. The division of labor is sometimes not a matter of any conscious intention on the part of the beings who divide their labor, and it has, even in those species, it has the advantages that Plato suggests. But I think the purpose of this kind of analysis, and this is sort of an early version of something we'll come back later to, it's kind of like social contract theory, where you're trying to think of the state as the product of some kind of agreement, some kind of a natural coming together of different people with different interests. And it has been a part of political philosophy just about forever, even though the great social contractarians are people we'll discover and we'll talk about much later, the people like Hobbes, for example, and someone who we won't be talking about specifically, Jean-Jacques Rousseau, great social contract theorist, and John Locke, another social contract theorist of sorts. Those folks came along much, much later, but you can see the roots of this idea even in Plato, even in Aristotle, the idea that we can understand society, we can understand the state as kind of a natural outgrowth of people's voluntary activity. And here Plato's suggesting that the communities, the value of community, and forget about this as history now, the value of community, the upshot of this story is supposed to be, is largely, maybe not exclusively, but largely due to the benefits of the division of labor. That's why we see people living in community. And then as you know, you think of more and more specialties that you'd want in your community, then all the other specialists, there have to be more of them to produce their special products for these new people you've just thought of. And so there's a kind of the growth of the community. Every time you think of something, as you're contemplating this thought experiment, every time you think of something, well, they'll need shoes, they'll need cloaks, you know, they'll need all kinds of different foodstuffs. There'll be some processing of raw materials that'll be needed, not just, you know, you've got to get the raw materials, different specialists will be needed for making them. And then every time you add a new specialist group, that brings in another group of people that you've got to provide food and clothing for, et cetera, et cetera. So this community grows naturally. And I think Plato imagined that there'd be sort of a limit to this, and it would probably be a relatively small community, relatively loosely organized, maybe nothing identifiable as a government at all. It's just a bunch of people who happen to be living in close proximity to one another and cooperating in their lives. But as long as the needs are kept basic, then there might be a level where we just sort of reach, you know, a natural limit in size, a natural limit in the things produced. But there's also this other natural, I think he imagines it's natural. Plato does anyway. I'm not sure so sure how Plato is trying to portray Socrates. Socrates seems to, you know, he has Socrates speak in the Republic as if he's sort of nostalgic, or he sort of thinks that there's something idyllic and nice about the small primitive society which does not seek luxuries. But Plato clearly mentions, as we've mentioned before, that it's the pursuit of luxuries that leads to the need for at least a couple of new specialties that hadn't been needed before. Okay? And one is this now once we need luxuries, that means we have to have more resources, we have to have new people that produce the luxuries. That means more expansion. And it's at some point in the pursuit of luxuries, which may very well be natural after we've established the necessities, it's in the pursuit of these luxuries that we start maybe banging into the following sorts of phenomena. First of all, on the outskirts of town, as we're going further and further out to try and get more and more resources, as we're looking for exotic things, we have to trade with other communities to get some of the things that are only available out there. They become some of the things that are luxuries, some of the things that you can't get here. So you need to establish trade relationships. You need to protect yourself against other communities that don't have as much as our community does. And you need perhaps to protect the community from internal strife, which arises because of the relative wealth, perhaps, of some compared to others. But you need police force, you need military services, and with that comes, you need someone who is gonna control the military and the police forces, in other words, a government. So it's with this need for luxuries that suddenly we need not just to have a community, a relatively loosely formed community, now we need the state. And we need the state with its armed force, and we need the rulers. Now, it's just this fact that the idea of needing armed forces, needing people in the military, and needing rulers, just because he's led up to this through this idea of the division of labor, that's part of what feeds his idea that these are specialists, right? These are specialists just like any others. These are specialists just like the basket weaver, the doctor. Only these specialties are extremely complicated and require a great deal more wisdom, a great deal more knowledge. They really do require a kind of character that we can't expect to be readily available in the populace. But they're cast as specializations, you know, specialty positions within the society, and that helps him in making his anti-democratic case. The case being that you don't want to just turn to anybody, and you certainly don't want to turn to majority rules to make decisions about these most momentous matters. You want to go to the person that knows best how to run the state when you're choosing a ruler. All right. Now, that brings us more or less to things said before, but it brings us up to them a little more gradually, more slowly. Plato, and this is what I want, now I want to address the question that you raised. Plato is absolutely aware of the dangers of tyranny, the dangers of tyranny in anybody's hands. In fact, that's one reason he hates democracy, is because he thinks it's going to turn into tyranny in a minute. Very, very brilliant speaker, great persuader, will come along and manipulate people to vote for them, and then as soon as they get the power, they won't turn it over to anybody else. Kind of the story of Hitler, the story of Hitler's rise to power in Germany. And it's a danger that I think everyone ought to recognize in democracies. Unless democracies have some sort of checks and balances, it's very possible that someone who really is not a good person can persuade people to vote for him or her, become the gain the power, and then not relinquish it. If the person gains sufficient power through making the people fearful of maybe alleged dangers, constitutions may be changed, powers may be transferred, limits to staying in office can be dropped. Everything depends on the persuasiveness of the politician. And this is a danger that you think Plato might have exaggerated, but it's a danger he felt very strongly. He thought democracies were extraordinarily dangerous just because of the danger that they might lead to tyranny. But how is Plato going to prevent society from falling victim to tyrants? There's an interesting idea here about the whole notion that the ruler should be the specialist that has two important consequences. One, it leads Plato to considering who we will choose for our rulers and how we will go about it. And two, what will the life of the rulers be like? Two really crucial components to his portrayal of the ideal society come from his worries about the dangers of tyranny. Yeah, what were you saying?
I was just going to say that what Plato wants to be king, it sounds like a big ego trip at the end, at least the part about Philaster's being king.
Well, I don't know whether, you could easily see it that way, because you think of him as a philosopher, right? Mm-hmm. But that's because he's in a book of it's collected philosophers. This is a philosophy course. But the word philosophy doesn't mean to Plato what it means to us. The word originally means simply nothing more than the lover of wisdom. Philosopher, philosophy. Originally in Greek, and of course he's Greek, right? Means love of wisdom. So, you're absolutely right that he says that the society won't really ever be well managed, well governed, until either the philosophers become kings or the kings become philosophers. But he's not thinking of people like me who have PhDs in philosophy. They didn't have stuff like that back then. As a matter of fact, he's not thinking of any particular subgroup in the academic world, because there was no academic world. In fact, the word academic world comes from the university that Plato founded, called the Academy in Athens. It was the first university, as far as we know. And the Academy was supposed to train people, among other things, to be more wise. So all he was saying in saying that the philosophers should become kings is that our society won't be well run until our kings are lovers of wisdom. He might have added, and of virtue. King, the rulers should love wisdom they should love virtue. Whether it takes us, whether it means that we have to replace the people who are presently kings with other people who are lovers of wisdom and virtue, or whether we can somehow turn the present kings into lovers of wisdom and virtue, until we can do that, we won't have a well-run society. Now, do you disagree with that?
Yeah, I think so.
Okay, tell me why. You think that the king, the rulers, should not be lovers of wisdom and virtue?
Well, I just don't think it's going to happen that way. Oh. I think that that you're not going to get these completely noble people that don't care about the power, they just want to help everyone. I just don't think that the people like that would be motivated enough to get
this
power.
All right, now see, this is you're sort of like Plato, I think, because the problem that you see, you know, how are we going to get people like that? That's the problem that motivates him, probably motivates most of what he says about how to accomplish this. Now again, it's utopian. It's certainly utopian. He's trying to portray the ideal state. But boy, he works very, very hard at trying to at least indicate what sorts of things would be required to get from here to there, to get from where we are now to this more utopian state where the philosophers are kings. That's the goal. How do we get there? What does he say? How would you think we could do it? Yeah.
Isn't it the cave, coming down in the cave and teaching them?
The cave doesn't explain how we're to get there. The little analogy of the cave talks about a lot of interesting things. Why it is, it's a very neat little tale. And among other things, it establishes Plato's view that there's a difference between what most people think and what's the truth. That the truth is often something that's difficult to figure out. And it also establishes some marvelous little side things, like, why it is that people would not appreciate, you know, the philosophers coming back and telling them what he sees in his esoteric studies. I mean, because the philosopher who's spending all of his time thinking about the abstract and thinking about justice and wisdom and virtue and all these things and trying to think about some very, very difficult subjects isn't going to be very good, you know, at trivial pursuit. I mean, it's basically like, you know, the people who are the real, you know, Plato, you know, talks about people rising up from the cave and learning as they move. You know, the cave portrays people as sort of watching these shadows on the wall. And there's a kind of a game that the participants, this is supposed to be us, right? And the us normal folks. And there's a little games that people play about saying, that's a this and that's a that, and trying to pick out what shape is what. And what they really don't know, because their heads are strapped to the wall, they don't know that, first of all, people are walking around behind them, casting these images on the wall with sort of like puppets or signboards or things like that, little shapes. Those things are, you know, the light that's being used, that's a fire behind them. And then what the people, even those people don't know, is that there's another, that farther up the cave, you can actually get into the light of day. So the people down here who spend their lives looking at these little transactions, these like little movies on the wall, or watching TV for that matter, I mean, they think it's real. They spend their lives watching the boob tube here, see? And they don't realize that it's fiction. They think that's life, that's reality. And it's only the people who make the torturous tour all the way up to the surface, outside the cave, those people see that's not reality. That's not even, you know, that's nothing compared to reality. Reality's out here. He says reality is at first blinding. I mean, people who climb up out of that cave and they're trying to look at things, they can't see them. Their eyes are used to the dark, and it takes them a long time to get used to the light. But finally they do, and they begin to appreciate reality. They finally find that the sun, which Plato, I don't know if it's included in this excerpt, but Plato sometimes treats the sun almost like, you know, almost, it's almost godlike. It's a good metaphor for God. It's the source of all light, just as God which is equated with the good, which is equated with lots of other things for Plato. God is the source of all truth and the source of all being for Plato. And he's not, when he starts talking like that, he's not one, you know, a traditional Greek polytheist. He's a monotheist, and he thinks there is this one principle of divinity. It is the principle of the one. It is the principle of the good. It is God. And it and the closest metaphor in the real world for that is the sun. The sun, finally, the person who's come out of the cave realizes that the sun's the source of all light and that reality is remarkably different from what he'd always thought. And then he says, I'll go back down and I'm going to liberate my friends and my family and my brothers and sisters. I'm going to go down there and liberate them. I'm going to explain this all to them. And he goes back down to the base of the cave, goes all the way back down to the bottom of the cave, and tries to tell them what reality is really like. But they don't believe him. They say, you're nuts. He's crazy. Fires, suns, that's nuts. Let's just see how good you are at playing our game. And of course, his eyes are now used to the light. He's back in the cave, and they start sitting down and see if he can still play the game properly, where he's picking out the dim shapes, and he can't see them anymore. And he can't play that game with them anymore. It's a wonderful analogy, wonderful little metaphor that really establishes, I think, what Plato means anyway by saying that, there's a lot of little ramifications. One, that there's this huge difference between what people perceive as true and right and good and what really is. And that it's not just a function of what people think. There is an objective truth. Even though most people will take it that those who depart from the things that most people think must be wrong, because most people don't think that. Plato tries to give this illustration. But there's also more to it. Like, he thinks that the philosopher, who's the person, and philosopher is not, again, somebody in a particular academic department. The philosopher is the person who's come to love the truth, love wisdom, love virtue, has come to make that his or her life. And I mean, this is the one person in history you can say his or her about. Because if you've read the passage, you'll see that men and women alike are certainly qualified to be rulers. He thought, and that's the one thing that he was probably ridiculed for more than any other thing among his contemporaries. But he said, whether you can see the truth or not is not a matter of gender. But the person who finally comes to see the light, there's other things in there that are objectionably sexist, I think, but there's this at least, when he's portraying who shall be rulers, it's the people who love virtue, who love wisdom. When they see that light, they really won't want to go back into the darkness. Especially when they know the reception that they'll receive. That people will doubt them, they won't believe them, they'll say, you know, you're nuts. What do you know? You can't even tell this shape from that anymore. You used to be one of the best people in this game and now you can't even play it. But those people who perceive the light, who see truth and justice, will realize they have an obligation to go back down. So what he says about rulers is, you know, they'll see, if you've done your job right, and we'll talk about what that job is, if you've done your job right in preparing the rulers, you'll have to drag them kicking and screaming to this job, but they'll do it. They won't want to. They'll do it. They'll be the ruler. They won't want to. The best kind of ruler you can have is one who really is good at the job, but doesn't want to do it. And that's, if you prepare the groundwork properly, that's what you'll get. Now, how do you prepare the groundwork properly? How do you do this job? How do you ward off the danger of tyranny? Well, Plato thinks that you do this through a long, and I mean long, process of education. It begins very close to birth, as soon, you know, even before birth. It begins in the plans that the ruling class make. At any stage, there'll be, you know, like if you try to apply this practically, I guess... you'd have to imagine that at any real stage of the development of society, there'll be some degree of wisdom achieved by those in power. They're the ones who are now going to try and improve things. And the way to improve this is to try and find, first of all, get the very best genetic products you can get, the people who are the wisest and most virtuous around, get them to breed with one another. Get them to breed with one another to provide the rulers of the future. Now, this won't always yield the desired product, but like in every other animal species, Plato says, you if you do this long enough, if you breed people for virtue and wisdom and for the capacity to learn and for intelligence and all of these things that are desirable characteristics in the rulers, you'll have some success. Some of it may very well be genetic. But you put that together, this breeding program, with a training program that lasts from birth till at least the age of 50. And what do you train them to do? Well, here's where I enlist you in on Plato's project. What you do is you figure out as best you can, and experience with this education program over time might teach us lots about what we should and shouldn't do, but at any particular point, you make this decision. You're trying to figure out what are the things we believe rulers should be able to do? What are the things we believe rulers should know? What are the traits that we think rulers should have? What are the traits we think rulers shouldn't have? And you take all of these considerations and you put them together and you build yourself a training program that ensures, as best you can, that each and every one of the people that go through the training program get the skills and the knowledge that you think they should have. In other words, flunk out the people that don't make it. You make sure that you choose the people who have and continue to have throughout their entire training exactly those traits that you want them to have, and who do not have any of the traits that you don't want them to have. You flunk out people. I mean, you might have a bunch of people in the program at the beginning, but you're watching them like a hawk. You want to weed out people who show character traits that you don't like, whether it's avarice or envy or jealousy or anything like that. You work very, very hard to make sure you weed out the people that are dangerous as rulers, and you keep in the people who are good. And there's going to be a lot of academic training in there. There's a lot of athletic training in there. He's got arts and music in his training program. And at the age of 50, they go over and they start pursuing wisdom. In other words, the training goes up until about 50. And then at the age of 50, he thinks people are prepared. They've got the right background. They know the facts. That's when they're prepared to sort of pursue some of these more abstract subjects, which I'm still calling philosophy, philosophical subjects, things that don't yet have clear-cut answers, questions about justice. Now, Plato, I think, thought that they had clearer-cut answers than I do. But that's how you do it. You have this lifelong training program. And if you've done your job right, when these people come out of the program at the age of 50, what they want to do is to study, to pursue wisdom, to learn more about virtue. They want to do these abstract things. But they will know, especially since society has invested so much in this whole training program, they will realize they have an obligation from time to time, not always, but from time to time. That group of people that has reached that level of training, they have an obligation to come be the rulers, to come guide the society, to make the decisions for the society, and to help them along its way. All right, so this long education process, which is central to Plato's whole idea, comes from his concern about the dangers of tyranny. He says, here's how we ward this off. We watch very, very carefully who we let through this program. We don't let, it's not the rich, and that's another factor. Because people who have an opportunity to own property might be inclined to misuse their power in order to increase the property that they have. Plato says that the rulers, and this is the auxiliaries and the rulers, all the people who are in these positions of power in society, they must never be allowed to own any property. If you want to be in that class, if you accept the pursuit of the various virtues that would, you know, you may wind up never getting to be a ruler. I mean, one of the things that they might decide in the training is you're probably best in the auxiliaries. You're virtuous, you're interested in wisdom, but you're not going to be leader capacity, you're military capacity, you're in the auxiliaries. But in any case, whether it's auxiliaries or guardians, the ruling class, those people may not, in principle, own property. Because if they were allowed to own property, this would provide a motive for people to sit through that training program and to go through the whole thing to get the power. If you tell them, you know, you go through the whole thing, and your reason for going through it should be your love of wisdom and your love of virtue, your interest in spending a life devoted to that. If you think that you're going to get the kind of power that will allow you to gain property, then think twice. That's not going to be allowed no matter what. Yeah?
You wouldn't spend that much time just to do something like that. It seems ridiculous.
I'm sorry. Spending, well, what if you loved it?
Well, I mean,
it seems ridiculous to you and perhaps to other people, but this is what they love. You're picking out people who love that.
Yeah, I agree with that. If you wanted to be a ruler, but if you're just in it for the power, it seems like a waste of time just to grab a little power by spending 50 years. Plus just the,
well, some people love power.
They would spend that much time just that.
Some people, I don't know. I mean, it's a thing to be warded off. And one reason for making the education that long and arduous is precisely to reduce the likelihood that somebody would sit through the whole thing on the off chance that maybe they'd make it all the way through and then be able to get power. I mean, if you make that really, really difficult, really, really unlikely, then all the better for this program. But, Plato, you know, some people may love power as much as these folks love wisdom, and it might be just a challenge to them. I'm confident that there have been people that love power that much. There are people who put up with an awful lot to gain power in the history of the world. So, I mean, I don't think it's ridiculous to imagine that some people just would love power that much, or might come to love power that much. Some of that particular love or trait could come along someplace in the course of the training. You know, that's why you have to keep your eyes out on these people. I mean, something might happen to them. They might get angry, and you got to watch out for this, how they respond to anger. And that's, Plato's very careful about saying we have to put all kinds of temptations in their way. We have to put all kinds of things like that in their way in order to just test them, to make sure we've got the right people. The upshot is, though, he imagines that it's to some degree or another, this utopian ideal, if you took these steps by establishing an education in which you weed out anybody who is not suited to be the kind of ruler that you want, and if you make sure that those people are not tempted by money, and here's another feature of the guardian life, the auxiliary in the guardian life. They may not have families of their own. Once they have children, the children are taken away and the children are raised by specialists. Think of them as the very best moms and dads in the city, the people who are really the best at raising children. Those are the people who will do the child raising, not the amateurs. I mean, he's really dedicated to this division of labor principle, right? So that not even parenting will be left to the amateurs. Even that should be done by professionals. Leaving, though, this is among the guardians and the auxiliaries, leaving the guardians and auxiliaries familyless. They shouldn't even know necessarily who has which of their sex partners is responsible for the child.
Right, they have multiple.
Yeah. And the reason for this is the same as the reason for borrowing property among them. The idea is that, one, we don't want people who are more concerned for their children getting into power, or more concerned for their relatives or their loved ones getting into power, than they are for wisdom and virtue. Because that may tempt them to abuse their power, to play favorites, to favor the people who are their relatives and their loved ones and their children. They should, Plato said, the guardian class and the auxiliary class should all think of one another as brothers and sisters. And the entire older generation of guardians, they should think of them as their parents. And the entire generation that follows them, they should think of them as their children. And the whole city is their project. It's the well-being of the whole city, in the end, according to Plato, the guardian should be concerned about. Yeah?
What do they do with their kids? Say that one of them isn't cut out to be.
Take him out of the program. That kid now will be, you know, he's not specific about this, and I can think of other options that aren't so good, but he doesn't think that they should be killed. The kid who doesn't show the talents or doesn't show the promise of being a guardian should be taken out of that program, sent to a different school, raised in a different way, perhaps now with family, with the opportunity to make wealth, to gain
actually,
property.
Maybe give the kid to a family?
Yeah. But you know, you might be doing some exchanging here. I mean, some of these details aren't clear in Plato. It might be that you find out there in one of the families that aren't in the guardian program, an auxiliary program, they aren't guardians and auxiliaries themselves. They're normal people. They're people who are, you know, making a living and living a life, and they've got families. It might be that in those families, you find one of these kids that has gold in their soul, who really shows the promise of being a guardian or an auxiliary. The ideal situation is to make sure that those kids get in the program, and the kids that may come from guardian parents who don't show that promise, they go out there in the real world. So there's kind of a communalism. It's not communism, because that's a word that really should be associated with Marx, and we'll talk about Marx later in the course. But there's a very severe communalism among the auxiliaries and guardians. And I want to insist that that's a very small part of the population, but it's a very vital part. Last word.
Well, if they take the kid out and make him a guardian, couldn't they show favoritism to their, he knows who their family is?
Well, if you get the kid early, that'd be a problem with making that kid a guardian, but if you can get that kid early enough so the kid doesn't really know his parents, I suppose Plato would say, I mean, having to wing it here, because Plato's dead and he can't provide all these details, one presumes that that might be a problem. If you take a kid too late, then that kid might already have been spoiled for being a guardian. So it might not be possible. The best thing to do is to try and find which kids are suited to being in the ruling class. Find that out as early as possible. You find it out early enough, then they won't know their parents. Right?
Forget.
No, well, I mean, they're too young. You get them like when they're 6 months old. They won't know their parents. And you destroy the records. You keep the records yourself.
I mean, you stand to your ability at 6 months?
Yeah, maybe. I mean, yeah, you got, you know, Apgar tests, things like that.
You got a strong grip.
Aristotle talks about what this whole idea of Plato's at some length. And Aristotle goes on to say what he thinks. So be aware of both things. Aristotle's criticisms of Plato, and then Aristotle's own views that he substitutes.